Why don't you give the Lord a hand clap of praise in this building? All right, why don't you give him a high praise in here? Woo. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. God, we give you honor and praise and glory. Come on, give him another hand clap of praise while we're here. I'm rejoicing with the work that Parkway done yesterday on outreach and inviting your five friends and having those people show up. Let me tell you how the Lord works. I had people come to me and said, I invited my five friends. All five didn't show up, but one showed up or two showed up. One man said four showed up. I had someone come to me that came back to the Lord. I've been knowing many years, did not know they were going to be here. And here's what they said. Said, for a solid week, I've been having dreams and waking up in the middle of the night. And when I would wake up, it would come to me, you need to get back to the house of God. And I thought to myself, I know the Lord's working. They came today, both prayed through, got baptized. But then I started thinking, if the Lord's working that hard for Parkway, how much harder should we be working for him? If the Lord's waking folks up, say it, for a solid week. And so I'm saying that to say this. I want you to get ready, because Jesus is about to open the floodgates of heaven to this place, and I promise you, God is fixing to use us, and we're going to reach all of Madison County, and everybody that needs to know Jesus and wants to know Jesus, they're going to find out that they can come right here and get everything that they need. Bishop said something today. He found out that 70% of Madison County, am I right? Madison, 70% don't go to church anywhere. Look at your neighbor and say, that's a lot. So if 70% don't go anywhere, why in the world would they not want to make this their home? But you know how they're going to make this their home? They're going to have to realize that we're here for them to come. We're fixing to go get them. We're fixing to bring them in. I'm telling you, they're about to come, and God's going to use us to do it, and I want you to get ready. We're going to change that little statistic, and we're going to say, you know what? It used to be 70%, but God put somebody on my mind, and when I went and got them, here's what the Lord done. Get ready, it's going to happen. I said, get ready, it's going to happen. But it's going to happen through us. Thanks for letting me be here last weekend and Wednesday and Sunday. And I told the staff today, I cut up so much. I get myself in more trouble cutting up. So if Wednesday night, it was kind of a little solemn. You know, it was a little different. So I broke out my ho-ho scripture. So that offended you, I'm sorry. But it was funny. But Brother Dylan said it was funny, so that's good enough for me. So anyway, you want me to tell them? Oh, okay. Well, it's in Zechariah 2 and 6 for people who don't really think there's a Santa Claus. Here it goes. Ho, ho, come forth and flee from the north. Now, there you go. There's a Santa Claus. God, I'm getting in trouble again. So anyway, go ahead and laugh. Tell somebody that's just a funny. I mean, you twist scriptures all the time to make it fit you. Yeah. Yeah. I heard a preacher preach about the hind's feet, and he was telling everybody that was a deer, and people had hind feet, and I was like, man, what are you talking about, a hind foot? And he talked about how people had hind feet, and then when he got done preaching about 20 minutes, he stopped. He said, can I be honest? And everybody was looking. He said, I don't have a clue what I'm talking about. He said, so if y'all don't mind, I'm going to preach something else. I thought, yeah, that'd be awesome because I'm confused. So anyway, I'm confused sometimes. So anyway, that little Santa Claus deal, it's okay. You'll get over it. So anyway, but there it really is. If you don't believe me, go to the mall, and for $5.50, you can take a picture with him. It says Santa Claus. So anyway, there he is. So we're having fun. All right, we're going to go to the Word of the Lord. Are y'all okay with that? I mean, it's just a little funny. All right. It's Christmas season, all right? Just be happy about it. If not, you're not going to get no gift from Santa. So there you go. That's right. I still believe in him because I like gifts. So there we go. All right. We're going to have a little fun here. I want to preach a little bit tonight. And I did. I asked the Lord, and I talked to the Lord again in the prayer room. And right over there, I asked the Lord again. And I wanted to make sure because I want to have the mind of the Lord, okay? And but I'm excited about what the Lord done here today, but it's only the beginning. It's because this is a working church. This church is not lazy, and this church loves Jesus. And it's because you've got great leadership that we're going to see great things happen in this house. It's why, man, where's the lady that had the heart deal? When I prayed for you, I am telling you, literally, I felt my body begin to get warm. I don't think that's ever happened to me before. When I laid, I don't know, I felt something literally begin to flow through my body when I laid hands on you. I don't know what all's going on, but I know one thing. The Lord touched you just a while ago. I know the bishop was speaking. I'm telling you, I felt it flow through my body. All right. 1 Thessalonians 4:15 through 17. And again, I'm not good with giving scriptures. I like to just kind of wait, but y'all got them beautiful screens. I'm not a good reader, so just kind of bear with me. And we're going to go right there. Thessalonians 4:15 through 17. And I feel the Lord here. I feel the Lord here. Are you good? Everybody there? It's in the screen. So here we go. The Bible said, "For this I say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a loud shout." I told people before, if you don't like it loud, you better not be in my section in heaven. You better be in another section, because he said he's going to descend from heaven with a loud shout. I'm going to be happy when I get there. I know there's going to be 30 minutes of silence. There might be some other folk going to be there before me, because when I get there, I'm telling you now, I'm going to get to screaming. Okay, I'm going to get to hollering. I'm going to get to shouting and bucking and snorting because I made it. You know what I'm saying? You go on and do it your way, but I'm going to do the loud shout, me. And the voice of the archangel and the trump of God and the dead in Christ shall rise first. I know some churches might go before this one because they're pretty dead. So anyway, dead in Christ shall rise first. And I know that's out of context, but it's fun. "Then we which are alive and remain." That's what I like. That bump your neighbor, say, "Now that's talking about you." "We which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." Now, I don't know about you, but I'm glad about that. We which are alive and remain, we're going to be caught up together with them, all right, in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And then in Thessalonians 5 and 16, you don't have to go there because I'm not going to read all that. But there's a short little verse, and here's what it says. It says, "Rejoice evermore." Now, I don't know about you, but I'm glad that I can rejoice. And no matter what's coming my way, if I'll just rejoice, I know something going to happen. If I just get to rejoicing, I know something is going to take place. All right? So in the next few minutes, just let me preach just a little bit. This is your day to rejoice. Is that all right? Are you going to preach with me? It's not late now, and I don't preach long if you'll preach with me. It's only 6:50. Are you ready? All right, give him a hand clap of praise, and when I'm done, and when you're done clapping, you can sit down, but you might not stay there. He just says, "Rejoice evermore." It was to the whole fifth chapter that was written by the Apostle Paul. He was instructing the church, and he writes to them, and he begins to say this concerning edifying one another. He said, "I want you to be at peace among yourself." And he warns against being unruly, and he admonishes to support the weak, and to be patient toward all men. In fact, the Bible said that he said that I see that none render evil for evil. In verse 17, he said, what I want you to do is I want you to begin to pray without ceasing. What he was saying was, he said, listen, when you begin to get something on your mind, if you'll just begin to pray and say, God, I'm not going to stop until something happens. I'm not going to give up until something begins to change. I know a lot of times we come to church, and if it don't happen just like we think that it's going to happen, that we say, well, maybe it's just not my time. Well, I'm telling you, the Bible said what you got to do is pray without ceasing. And here's what I've learned to do. No matter what state I find myself in, I can always say, hey, God, here I am right now, and I need you to help me. I need you to bless me. So I'm telling somebody, you might have to just pray a little bit without ceasing. In verse 19, it said to quench not the spirit. And people say, well, what do you mean about quenching? It's about when you want to say amen, but you don't do it because nobody else has said it. It's when you want to shout, but you won't shout because somebody else ain't shouting. It's when you want to run the aisles, but you're worried about what somebody else is going to think about you. That Bible said, quench not the spirit. I'm glad that I'm in a church that when I want to shout, I can shout. When I want to run, I can run. When I want to clap my hands, I can clap my hands. If I want to stomp my feet, I can stomp my feet. If I want to high-five somebody, I can high-five somebody. I'm telling somebody at Parkway, don't you dare let anybody quench your spirit. You say, I'm going to shout, I'm going to run, I'm going to buck, I'm going to snort, I'm going to do whatever I want to do. If it gets too crazy, somebody will help you. Verse 20 said, despise not prophesying, meaning that when you feel the unction of the Holy Ghost, open your mouth and say what saith the Lord. If you miss it, we'll judge it and find the next one. It'll be all right. Try again. You might get it right the next time. I can't figure out why we think it's all the old people got to prophesy. I'm waiting on the day when a young person just jumps up, kicks their head back, and says, yay, saith the Lord. I'm talking about when you feel an unction of the Holy Ghost, that you stay up and say, hey, I'm feeling the Holy Ghost, and let me tell you what God has to say when it's decent and in order. Where I come from, they still judge them. What they did. Somebody crank one off, they used to say, judge that word. Them say, mm-mm. They say, all right, it's all good and ain't nothing hurt. Let's wait a few minutes and get the real word. That's how we used to do where I'm from. I'm telling you right now, only way you're going to learn how to follow after the Holy Ghost is you got to practice. Only way you're going to learn how to follow out the Holy Ghost, you're going to have to try it a time or two. You ever stepped out and prayed for somebody and they didn't get what they wanted and you go, oh, my God, I don't know. Let me tell you something. If you'll take the credit when something goes wrong, you'll take the credit when something goes right. What you need to do is say, you know what? I'm just going to step out and be fled of the Holy Ghost. When I get ready to pray, I'm going to pray. And if I make a mess of it, I apologize, but it ain't going to stop me because I'm going to pray again. I'm telling somebody, you better not despise prophesying. When you feel it in the Holy Ghost, you... If you ain't clear with it, run up here and grab the bishop, grab pastor, and say, look, this is what the Lord telling me. And he get up there, do like little John Mark does his daddy, and Mark Anthony, he goes. And then they go, yes or no. Listen, if that's what you feel and you feel in the Holy Ghost, why don't you say, that's how you can start feeling the unction of the Holy Ghost. And that's how you can start saying, because what you going to do when you're on your job and you start feeling something and you're thinking, and all of a sudden God starts dealing with you about helping somebody, but you done, oh, you say, well, I don't really know. Go on and step out in the Holy Ghost and say, you know what? What's the worst that can happen? Some of us need to open our mouth and say, you know what? This is what God gonna do. Verse 22, and he said, abstain from the very appearance of evil. But right in the middle of the great discourse of needful instruction, there was that little scripture that seemed like it was almost out of place. You say, what do you mean? Because he said, pray without ceasing. See that none render evil for evil. Quench not the spirit. Despise not prophesying.
Abstain from the appearance of evil. But right in the middle of all that, here's what he said. Rejoice evermore. I've learned something about rejoicing. Rejoicing was a command. And if it was obeyed, here's what happens. It unlocks the doors to battles being won. When I don't feel like worshiping, I'm telling you, that's when I'm going to do it. When I don't want to worship, that's when I'm going to do it. When I don't feel like giving no praise, that's when I'm going to do it. When I don't feel like giving an amen, that's when I'm going to do it. When I don't feel like clapping my hands, that's when I'm going to do it. When I don't feel like running the aisle, that's when I'm going to do it. Somebody said, well, that's all about emotion. No, that's about making the devil mad and saying, you're not going to steal my victory. You're not going to steal my... He didn't say rejoice some of the time. He didn't say rejoice when things were going well in your life. He didn't say rejoice when everybody's being your friend. He didn't say rejoice when your favorite preacher's preaching. He just said rejoice evermore. That word means a always rejoicing, a perpetual rejoicing, meaning that no matter how you feel, you've got to rejoice if you want to please God. Unfortunately, some churches, they done replaced the joyful songs of victory with mournful songs and depressing strings. Instead of blowing the trumpets of gladness and singing songs of jubilee, some prefer the songs that magnify the misery of man and ignore the magnificence of God. I'm going to tell you, we need to sing songs that magnify the King. We don't need to be singing those songs that don't magnify the King. We need to sing songs that talk about the blood. We need to sing songs. I ain't going across no desert searching for something. I ain't searching for God. God's already here. What I'm looking for a God that when I begin to raise my hands, it's the blood that's going to save me. It's the blood that's going to change me. That's why that song said, what can wash away your sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Thank God we got an apostolic, loving God working that tries to usher in the presence of the Lord. These singers and musicians, they're not just playing for your enjoyment. The Bible says they're minstrels. And when they prophesy upon the instruments, that's what got us ready for the war. That's why I love the songs they sing. The songs they sing here, it's always magnifying the King. They ain't searching for him. They ain't looking for him. They ain't feeling after him. They're not stuck off in some desert sand. I'm telling you, God's already here. When you step into this place and they begin to sing, you need to throw your hands in the air and say, God, I'm going to rejoice evermore. I don't care what nobody does. I'm going to get what I want from you. Some have turned their churches into fashion shows instead of a place of worship. Some have turned them into political rings instead of a place of thanksgiving. Some have purposely avoided any show of emotion in worship because they're scared they might offend somebody. I know a church, I won't tell you where, they just told them at the church in front of everybody, I don't want nobody speaking in tongues. Told his own mama, don't want you speaking in tongues, mama, you might scare the people. I know what I'd have done. I'd have cranked off, I'd have made me up a tongue. I'd have told them, see my tie, I tie my tie. I'd have said, see the key to my Honda. I'm telling you now, I would have come up, I'd have said, yabba dabba doo. I'm telling you now, there ain't nobody going to quench the spirit at Parkway. I'm telling you, there ain't nobody going to quench. Somebody going to say, I'm going to rejoice. I don't care what happens. Somebody better get out and say, I'm going to rejoice. I don't care. Rhetoric and logic has replaced the words of God, and poetry and philosophy has replaced anointed preaching. They want to, I ain't even going to go there. I'm going to just go on. And in the name of education and enlightenment, I ain't against smart people. I just ain't one. I ain't against education. School wasn't my best subject. My best subject when I did go was lunch and PE. I tried to take two of them in the same day. Yeah, I only went to see my friends. But because of education and enlightenment, you see many churches is dying. They want to talk about all the philosophies of life. We got people that run 20,000 people, and you never hear the word God. You never hear the word Jesus. You never hear the word repentance. You never hear the word baptism. All you're going to get is a little life lesson. I got news for us. A life lesson ain't going to change you. But I tell you what, you get a life lesson going on in you, and you come meet the Father, and you come and let the blood of Jesus cover you. I'm telling you what it will do. It will change your life. You got to rejoice even when you don't feel like it. He said, honor and majesty are before him, and strength and gladness are in his place. He said, for the kingdom of God, it's not just meat and drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. You see, I ain't on nobody, but I'm going to help us here. I'm going to help me here. Not because there's times, I ain't going to lie. There's times, man, I go to church, I'm going to be up front with you. I feel locked down. See, I'm being transparent. I know. I'm telling you, I go to church, I feel locked down. I go to some churches, I ain't lying, Bishop. I be begging, Jesus, Lord, let the keyboard fall apart or something. I was at one church, and this old kook, I'm telling you, he loves me, and I pick at him. Every time I go, he tries to run in the ground because he don't want nothing good to happen. I mean, he be singing songs I ain't never even heard before. I mean, just running in the ground. When he got done, I said, well, you done? He said, yeah. I said, we're still going to have a move of God. I'm telling you now, you can't stop a move of God. I don't care what your spirit says, you can't stop a move of God. If you can just find one person that says, hey, God, here I am. God said, I'm already here. All I need, I'm telling you, you can't stop a move of God. You might be sitting by some old deadhead. It don't matter. Just shout anyway. Just say, you ain't going to stop my move. I'm going to rejoice. See, not to rejoice implies that he's isn't here. Not to rejoice implies that there's a lack of faith. Not to rejoice implies that there's an absence of love and hope. Jesus said, these things have I spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. 12 times in the letter to the Philippians, Paul began to tell them to rejoice in the Lord. And some may ask the question here, well, when should I rejoice? You ain't got to throw them all up there because we're going to throw a bunch of them out. When shall I rejoice? Philippians 4:4 says, always. So you know what? No matter how you feel, you got to rejoice. No matter what it looks like, you got to rejoice. No matter how sick you are, it don't matter if you can't just got to put your arm on the back of the pew and do your finger like that. Just rejoice. If it don't look like it working good, point at it and say, look, Jesus, I'm rejoicing. I'm hurting, but I'm rejoicing. Why to rejoice? Because the Bible says that we are commanded. And then it said where to rejoice. I'll show you. The Bible says whatever state you find yourself in. You said, but I'm going through hell. Just rejoice. I got problems in my life. Just rejoice. I got problems at my job. Just rejoice. I got problems in my money. Just rejoice. I got problems in my marriage. Just rejoice. I got problems with my neighbor. Just rejoice. I got problems with the people that live. Just rejoice. Because when you get to rejoicing, the devil ain't got no choice but to do it with you. How to rejoice? I'll give you some scriptures. How to rejoice? The Bible says to rejoice in prayer. The Bible says to rejoice in preaching Christ. It says rejoice in faith. It says rejoice in godly living. It says rejoice in Christ's day. It says rejoice in sacrifice and service. It said rejoice in fellowship. It said rejoice in the Lord. It said rejoice in the worshiping of God. It said rejoice in the care of the church. It said rejoice in salvation. It said rejoice rejoice in truth. It says rejoice, here you go, when others walk in truth. It said rejoice in the salvation of souls. It said rejoice in the hope of God's glory. It said, you like this one, rejoice when your name is written in heaven. Here you go for all the ones that say, well, it says rejoice when you're tempted. It said rejoice when you're tried. It said rejoice when you're sorrowful. It said rejoice when you're persecuted. It said rejoice when you're suffering for Christ's sake. I'm here to tell somebody at Parkway, this is your day to rejoice. It doesn't matter what nobody says. I'm telling you, 35, getting the Holy Ghost is only the beginning. That's going to be a common thing. I'm telling you, you got to rejoice no matter what the world says. You say, well, is it going to work? Yeah, it's going to work. Is it going to happen? Yeah, it's going to happen. You said, how do you know it's going to happen? Because, you see, God don't lie. So when you need something from God and you want something from God, you can't worry about nobody else. And you got to say, all right, God, I'm coming to get what I want. You know what, everyone? You know, I'm going to be honest. Sometimes you got to get selfish. Sometimes you got to get desperate. And you got to say, look, I know we got a lot of hurting people, God, but I ain't talking about them right now. I'm talking about me. You know what I'm saying? Every once in a while, you got to hit yourself and say, look, God, I'm talking about me. I told y'all that story about that boy needing $100. I already told y'all that story. If you forgot it, I'll tell you again. That boy down there praying, needing $100. Guy sitting next to him kept listening to him. The guy just reached in and gave that guy $100. Said, here you go, man. The Lord's answered your prayer. Go on. So the guy walked out the door. The guy stood up and said, all right, God, look, I done took care of that $100. Now I'm talking about me. Every once in a while, you got to worry about you. Every once in a while, you got to say, look, if you just come into the church and you're always leaving here and you was down in the dumps as when you got here, you didn't rejoice. You say, yeah, but you ain't got to go home where I got to go home. No, but I'm going to tell you what you do. If you rejoice when you get home, things are going to be different. If you begin to rejoice when you get back to where you're at, something's going to be different. But I'm telling somebody in here, you're going to have to pull yourself up out of bootstraps and say, no matter what it looks like, I am going to be a rejoicer. No matter what it looks like, I'm going to rejoice in no matter what. I ain't crazy. I live in the real world. Transmission blow up. Oh, my God. Just rejoice. Flat tire. Just go on and rejoice. I'm going to be up front. I got to preach to myself sometime. I get a little mad. Then I got to remind myself, you better go on and rejoice. It's going to work out. Because sometimes Jesus knows what's going on. I never forget them calling me, telling me my house burnt down at the campgrounds. Brother Sibley called and said, Brother Smith, your house burnt down. I said, oh, praise him. He said, Brother Smith, Brother Sibley here. He said, can you hear me? I said, yes, sir. He said, did you hear what I said? I said, I think so. He said, your house has just burnt to the ground. I said, oh, praise him. He hung up on me. Called back a few minutes later. He said, Brother Smith. I said, yeah. He said, Brother Sibley here. I said, yes, sir. He said, can you hear me? I said, yes, sir. He said, did you hear what I said a while ago? I said, I did. He said, what did I say? I said, you told me my house burnt down. He said, that's exactly what I said. He said, and did you say praise him? I said, I sure did. He said, why in God's name would you say that? I said, well, I don't have insurance on it for number one, but Jesus said he'd give me beauty for ashes, so that means I must be getting a better one. And guess what? I got a better one right now. God took care of that for me. What you saying? I don't care what kind of dilemma you in, you need to rejoice right now. I don't care what's going on in your life, you need to rejoice right now. I don't care what the doctor said, you need to rejoice right now. I don't care what the banker said, the lawyer said, the neighbor said. I don't care what your spouse said, you ought to rejoice right now. And it ain't for the show of emotion. It's just to make the devil mad that what you going through, you going to shout past it and say, there's going to come a day, devil, that I'm going to be able to look at you and say, you're a liar, liar, pants on fire, because I never gave up on God. I'm telling somebody, don't you dare give up on God. Sometimes God moves things because it ain't good for you. I can show you Bible. I can show you Bible where you can change God's mind. I can show you, Bible, that you'll keep on nagging him long enough that he'll say, all right, you want that? I'll give it to you. But when he didn't say it, I'm saying it. But when all hell breaks loose, here's what he's saying. Don't come crying like some old titty baby, because I tried to keep it from you anyway. Everybody want to talk about little Jesus wept, Jesus wept. Everybody got their own philosophy. I'm going to tell you why Jesus wept. I'm going to give you a little revelation. I asked my elders before I ever said it. This will only be about the third or fourth place I've ever said it, because people go, oh. I ask people all the time, why Jesus wept? Well, he wept because, you know, no faith in the house. He wept because he couldn't die. He wept. I'm going to tell you why Jesus wept. Mary and Martha was down there, wouldn't shut up. They kept on yankety, 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 yank, telling Jesus, get on down here. We need you to come help. Lazarus is about to die. Then all of a sudden, Lazarus is dead. Now he's been dead 4 days. He's stinking. That's what the Bible says. 2 days, 3 days wasn't no big deal. On the fourth day is when the man came through and said, he's dead. So now Jesus shows up. He had already just said, got faith the grain of a mustard seed. Look at the mountain, same room here to hunt, hence the yonder place, and nothing shall be impossible to you. He just said that. He's talking about a little rock. He says, hey, they was, Jesus, if you would have been here, Lazarus wouldn't be dead. Kept on. So Jesus said, no problem, no problem. The Bible said, Jesus said, roll away the stone. The Bible says, Jesus wept. And then he said, Lazarus, come forth. You know why Jesus wept? The Bible had already said that Lazarus was in the bosom of Abraham. Lazarus already had it made. But because them wouldn't shut up, Jesus said, all right, Lazarus, you're going to be mad. Come home. Come on back. Come back on earth again. Can you imagine being in heaven and getting called back? I know how you would act. You would say, oh, thank you. I am so glad I'm going to get to punch in and go to work tomorrow. Thank you. Can you imagine Lazarus going to his sisters and saying, oh, let me wash your feet. I'm going to tell you what Lazarus said. I'm telling you, they got stuff in the Bible that I should have helped write. I'm going to tell you what Lazarus said. Lazarus said, have you lost your ever-loving mind? I had it made. I was kicking back with the king, and I heard you two crazies down there that wouldn't just shut up and kept on, and now here I am, and I got to come back down and go to work and mess with you two. I'm telling you now, God takes things out of your life sometime that you don't need, but you're just going to keep on, and it's going to come back, and it's going to wreak havoc in hell, and then you want to complain. Sometimes you get things that you didn't need from the get-go. But you didn't ask. I'm 50 years old. I still don't do nothing unless I ask somebody. When it's a major decision in my life, in my ministry, in my family's life, oh, I don't just have this revelation, eat a lot of peach, and start having these dreams about, I call the elders. And I love them, but I don't take one's answer. I'm talking to all of them. I call them all, and I don't tell them, well, I've talked to so-and-so, so they'll call and try to come up with a consensus. I want to hear what Jesus is saying. Somebody said, well, you can't hear from Jesus for yourself? Yeah, I can, but I'm just worried. If I make a mistake, I'm trying to figure out which one I'm going to move in with. Because if it's the wrong answer and it goes south, I'm telling you what I'm doing. I'm calling. I'm saying, hey, bud, I'm moving in with you because you told me. Y'all go on and do it the way you want, but I'm telling you my way works. Because you know why? I ain't got no sad stories. I ain't going to lie. I ain't got no sad. I've been evangelizing 13 years. I ain't never been canceled. I ain't never got a hot check. I ain't never not been able to go back. I ain't never been called on. I ain't never been called down. I've been rebuked a time or two. That's when I got home. But you know why? It's because I had a man of God in my life. And I'd talk to that man of God, and I'd say, hey, man of God, I'm thinking about, and he'd say, you know what? We need to do that. And man, when the man of God would look at me, he'd go, you know, I knew right. I said, "Woo, you ain't got to say." I didn't tell him because he's the man of God. But when I got in the car, I'd look and I'd say, you know what that meant? She said, I know what that meant. What that meant was you better not do that. Even when I wanted to do it, that flesh said, you better go on and do it. I'm going to tell you now, when I know what's going on and I know things that are happening, I go to the man of God in my life. Talk to that man and I say, hey, listen, I don't come and say, you know, Pastor, the Lord's been speaking to me. and I feel like I ought. Man, when you say that, if he's a smart man of God, you know what he's going to say? You know what? You have been hearing from Jesus. Go on and do that. Because if he tells you no, you know what you're going to do? You're going to go look for another man of God. You're going to go try to find one that's going to agree with you. But when you go to that man of God, I told y'all about that Wednesday, about that guy had some 450 prophets. And they say, man, I can't go, 450. And he says, I can't go to that one because that one don't never tell me nothing good. See, that one, you know what he did? He told him the truth. He had 450 liars and he had one truth teller. And go to that man of God. Man of God, he's going to save you for some things. When it don't look like, when it don't, you know what I'm talking about. It, you know, you that's my age now, when mama and daddy said something, you'd be like, I know better than that, when you was younger. And then when it came on around and poof, there it was, you'd be like, boy, mama was right. Mama was right. And then when you get older and then you start telling your kids and you see the same expressions you done, they'd be like, I'm going to tell you, I learned through life lessons. I'm still talking, Joyce, and it's okay. Because here's why, when you listen to the man of God and it goes right, you're going to have something to rejoice about. It's funner to rejoice when it's going right than it to go wrong and you got to force yourself to rejoice. Rejoicing works either way, but it's a lot funner when you can come. Benjamin said, hey, Bishop, you told me. Hey, Pastor, I didn't really know, so I came to you, and then you told me. And it happened just like y'all told me. And the Bishop's going to say, ooh, let's rejoice. It's a lot funner to do that than to come back and say, well, it didn't work, but will you rejoice with me anyway? It ain't as fun. It ain't as fun to rejoice when it didn't go your way. Somebody said, well, my God. Do I got to come to the pastor and the bishop about everything? I didn't say come about everything. But when you're going to make a life-changing decision, when you're going to go get something that could put your family in jeopardy, when you're going to make a move, you know, used to, people would find a good church bishop, and they would move there, and then they would look for a nice job. Nowadays, people searching the dollar and just try to find a church to fulfill. Used to move and you would establish yourself in a good church, a holy church, an apostolic church, and then you would go look for your job. But now, chase the money and then just try to find a good church. I ain't making no moves till I talk to the bishop. I ain't making no purchases of any amount before I talk to the man of God in my life. I ain't doing nothing crazy. Because I'm telling you, I'm selfish. Because if something go wrong, somebody's going to help me pay for that. If something goes south, I'm borrowing something from somebody. Something's going to change. Because I done went to the man of God in my life. But I learned something about the man of God in my life. He never, not one time ever, led me astray. Because you know why? He ain't just going to pop off. And he ain't just going to pop off because... He's going to talk to the king, and he's going to try to find out what's best for your life. And when he gets done talking to the king, it might not look like it's the right thing now, but you just hang in there, because when it's all said and done, it will be the right thing. That's right. Amen. I'm telling you what I know, and the reason I'm saying that is because God's got greatness for this church. And don't let nobody try to fool you. And this ain't the place to be. And if you've made a boo-boo or something's went wrong, it ain't like, well, my God, I might as well go to town. I done made the boo-boo. No. No. Just rejoice and get past the boo-boo. And then next time, come and say, hey, I need a little help. I need a little help. Don't come and say, the Lord done told me. I'm going to tell you, man, I ain't never heard the voice of the Lord.
Boom. Not one time, ever. Not one time. I ain't never heard like,
here is me.
I ain't never heard none of that. Not one time. But when I feel impressed, but I know what the Lord did do, he put man of God in my life and put men of God in my life that would govern me and help me and lead me and guide me to where I'm at today. And I had people, Bishop, here's what they'd tell me. How long are you going to serve that old boy and get nothing for it? How long are you going and not? How long are you going? I said, you know what? I'm going to do it until he says you're done doing it. And right now, I can go back to most of those guys. And them guys right now, they can't find it with both hands. They don't have a clue what's going on. And I'm preaching the world. I'm not boasting. I'm telling you what I know. You know why? It's because I submitted to the man of God in my life. You think I'm kidding? I'm telling you what's happening. Well, I feel the Holy Ghost right here. The enemy's been lying to a few people, and you're thinking about maybe making a move or making a change. I'm telling you in the Holy Ghost, don't you go nowhere. This is your house. Well, I feel the Holy Ghost here strong. Don't go nowhere. Don't let the devil, I'm telling you, I can have good with two as I can with 2,000, so it ain't about the number to me. I'm telling you what I feel in the Holy Ghost. It's like the enemy's been attacking and trying to get something in your mind. I'm telling you, under the unction of the Holy Ghost, God has something great for this house, and because you are part of this house, you're going to be in the unction. It's going to happen. There's going to be greatness here. I know what I know in the Holy Ghost. I'm done preaching. I preach way longer than I should have. But here's the deal. If you want God to bless you and you want him to do something through you and for you, would you lift your hand? You want him to do that. All right? All right, put your hands down. I just want you to stand. I just want you to stand. And I just want you to begin to come down to the front. I know I'm doing altar way different tonight. Come on, our altar team. Come and line up. Force your way through the crowd. Just come and line up. Just come and line up. You'll have to come. And if you need something from the Lord, God bless you. That's right. Harayaba Shandeha. Niraya nanana mama shandeha nariya nanada baha. Hey. Iraya nanana shandeha nariya nanada baha. Oh, boy, there's an anointing on some of you people. I could literally come put my hand on you. And God's got his hand all over you. And it's going to be all right. I feel that strong in the Holy Ghost. It's going to be all right. Come on, people are coming down from all over the congregation. Just spread it. That's right. Come all the way down. Coming from all over the congregation. Call anybody you want. It's all right. Sister Serena can just play. If you want all these to come help you, tell them to come on. Pastor, tell them. Come on. Tell them what to do. It's all right. She can play and make us sound spiritual. Come on, we're about to pray in here. We're about to pray. Just let them help us pray. Let them help us pray. Yeah. They're leaders. They're not just singers. She has equipped them to pray for people and worship. I've heard that choir and that ensemble and that chorale. I've heard them pray. They pray. Y'all help, that's right, Pastor. Y'all help us pray tonight, singers.